We want to welcome you to Eastside tonight. We are glad to have you with us. If you are not a member or a regular tender, you're a special guest. I hope you got a bulletin. If you did, you're going to see there's a welcome tab on the edge of the bulletin. If you're a guest, please fill that out, tear it off, and drop it in the offering plate because we do want to get to know you a little better. Let's begin by asking the Lord's blessing on our time of worship. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for another opportunity to gather in God's house. We thank you for the fellowship of the saints. We thank you for the opportunity to just praise the glory and honor of your name. Lord, we know that will be our eternal vocation, and we gladly enter into it tonight. We love to sing your praises. We love to proclaim your word, and we love the fellowship of the saints. We ask that you would visit your people in a special and intensive manner tonight. We pray that the Holy Spirit will be present, and, Lord, that you will be glorified and lifted up. For it's in Christ's name we pray these things. Amen.
Our first hymn is, if you've looked in your bulletin, was a childhood favorite. Most of you don't need words, at least for the first stanza, but you might for the rest of the song. So let's stand together and sing Jesus Loves Me. And we'll welcome each other in the Lord.
Thank you.
our last hymn. This is one of my favorite hymns. You'll probably laugh because all the hymns wind up being my favorite hymn, but this one really is one of my favorite hymns. Down at the cross, I think the fourth stanza is my favorite. Come to the fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Let's sing together.
Message, pay these tithes and offerings. Amen. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, choir, for that. That was beautiful. I know we're fewer in number tonight. I guess the weather hampered some folks. Somebody texted me and said there were tornado watches out tonight. I'm not sure if that was the case. I texted back and said, I think we're okay. We're in a low place. We'll be all right. First Baptist and Flat Rock are on hills, though. I said, I don't know. They're probably doomed, but we'll be okay. So. If you got your Bibles, let's turn over this evening to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5, we're continuing our series talking about moments with the Master, encounters with Jesus Christ that transformed people's lives, that were transformational in their encounter. Tonight, we're going to look at a tearful moment in which Jesus encounters a situation, a tragic situation. And the truth is, all of us, from time to time, encounter tragedy. We have problems, infirmity, death. It's just part of being a human being. And whether it is a broken body, a broken heart, or a broken spirit, tragedy is going to touch every one of us. Jesus put it this way in John 16:33. He said, "In this world you will have tribulation." Job says in Job 14:1, he says, "Man is of few days, and those are full of trouble." It's just part of being human. Tragedy will come our way. But the Bible teaches that Jesus is adequate for every situation. No matter how bad your situation, no matter how dark the night, how deep the water, how hot the fire, Jesus is sufficient for every situation. And in this passage tonight, we are confronted with a tragic situation. There is a father who is experiencing tragedy in his family. His 12-year-old daughter is sick. She is at the very point of death, and he is heartbroken. And in the midst of his tragedy, he turns to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he finds that Jesus is more than adequate for the situation. Tonight, I want us to see how we can transform, how Jesus transforms defeat into victory, death into life. Mark chapter 5, beginning in verse 21. "Now when Jesus had crossed over again by boat to the other side, a great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jarius by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, 'My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed, and she will live.' So Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy, inspired, and inerrant word. We thank you that we can trust everything that you have said, that we know that it is true and that it is reliable, and that we can order our life according to it. We thank you for the scripture that you give us tonight. Lord, we ask that you would teach us thereby, that you would instruct us, guide us, direct us, and help us to grow as disciples. In Jesus' name, amen. In our scripture tonight, this man by the name of Jarius is encountering one of the greatest struggles of his entire life. Now, this is a man who has accomplished much. The Bible tells us in verse 22 that he is a ruler of the synagogue. This is a man of power and position in the community. When he enters into a room, people stand up. When he talks, people listen. This is a man who is secure. This is a man who is probably well-educated. This is a man who seems to have everything together. But now he finds himself in a place where none of that matters, where his education, his position, his power, his wealth, none of it matters anymore because something else more important has entered into his life. Sickness and death. Sickness and death care very little about who you are, about what your possessions are, about what your position is. Jarius is a man who is religious, but his religion is powerless to help him in this situation. And I guarantee you, if you'd gone to Jarius and you had offered him the opportunity to exchange all of his power and his possessions and everything that he had for the life of his 12-year-old daughter, he would have taken it in a moment. See, death had come to his house, and it had come for his real treasure, his little daughter. Luke tells us it is his one and only daughter, and she is dying. His real treasure is dying. You know, some people spend their entire lives amassing wealth and power and position, but they find that when tragedy comes, none of that matters. Death doesn't care if you're a millionaire. Sickness doesn't matter. It doesn't care if you have power. Sorrow doesn't care if you have prestige or position in the community. Sorrow and suffering don't care about your popularity. Death and hell and the grave could not care less who you are or what you've accomplished in this life. When death comes calling, you had better know one greater than yourself. And when death came, Jarius knew where to go. The question I have for you tonight is that when death stalks you, when it comes to your door, do you know where to go? Do you have anywhere to turn like Jarius did? You see, somewhere Jarius had heard about this man, this teacher, this rabbi named Jesus. I think it's interesting that the name Jarius means he whom God enlightens. Somehow Jarius had been enlightened. He came to understand who Jesus was and that Jesus was his only hope. And now, at the very moment that his daughter is dying, when he has nowhere else to turn, Jesus is passing through his town. What a coincidence. Folks, there are no coincidences. God is in charge of everything. It was God's divine plan that allowed the paths of Jarius and Jesus to cross at this very moment. You look through history, often history seems to be filled with remarkable coincidences. Folks, there are no coincidences. God plans everything. He knows everything. He sees everything. Everything happens for a purpose and a reason. Back in 1858, there was a Sunday school teacher by the name of Edward Kimball. And by coincidence, there was a young man who began attending the church where he taught Sunday school. The young man's name was D.L. Moody. And by coincidence, he went by D.L. Moody's place of work, a shoe store, on a Saturday. And by coincidence, nobody happened to be in the shoe store that day. And so he could sit down and talk with D.L. Moody, and he led him to Christ. What a coincidence. It was no coincidence, just as it was no accident, that years later, D.L. Moody led a man by the name of Wilbur Chapman to Christ. And Wilbur Chapman, just by happenstance, encountered a man by the name of Billy Sunday, who was a baseball player, and led him to Christ. And Billy Sunday happened to encounter a man by the name of Mordecai Ham, whom he led to Christ. And Mordecai Ham, in 1934, happened to be preaching a revival in Charlotte, North Carolina, when a young boy by the name of Billy Graham attended and came to Christ. Folks, none of those things are circumstances. It was all God's plan. You see, we can look at an apple tree and we can count how many apples on it is on the tree, but God knows how many apples are in every seed. Notice how this man of position and power, this man named Jarius, came before Christ. He comes to him reverently, prayerfully, passionately. The Bible says that he falls at Jesus' feet in verse 22. In other words, this big man humbles himself in the presence of the Lord of glory. He comes down from his high position and humbles himself before the Lord. Folks, I want you to know that is a secret that many people never learn. Before you are ever going to get anywhere with the Lord Jesus Christ, you must humble yourself. You're going to have to humble yourself in His presence. You're going to have to get very small before Him. You're going to have to come to a place where He is everything and you are nothing. One of the great truths in the Bible is that the way up is the way down. Jesus makes this clear in James chapter 4, verse 6. He says, but He gives us more grace. Therefore, He says, God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. When we come to a place when we recognize our inability and God's ability, then we are finally in a position to receive what we need from Him. This man humbles himself before Jesus. He falls down before Him, and he makes his petition to the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, I cannot do this thing. This is something that is beyond my ability. It's beyond my capacity to heal my daughter, but I believe you can. You can do this. I can't, but you can. What a statement of faith here. And this is the place in life that we need to get to. Whether it is for our own salvation, where we are seeking the salvation of Jesus Christ, or whether we are seeking the salvation of a loved one, or we're trying to reach the place where we can deal with our trials and our temptations and our difficulties, we have to come to the place where we recognize when we can't, God can. Christ can. If any of you have ever been acquainted with Alcoholics Anonymous, AA, their 12-step plan, one of the 12 steps is that you must acknowledge that you cannot conquer this addiction on your own. That what you need is a higher power. Now, if it was me, I would change that to what you need is Jesus. Because Jesus is the only higher power that can break addictions and change lives and cause dead men to rise from the grave and can break anything that holds you. When we can't, Jesus can. So this man comes to Jesus. And he comes to Jesus and he lays this before Jesus. Folks, there are some in this room tonight that have been trying to fight battles in their own power. And they keep losing. You're fighting an addiction. You're fighting a habit. You're fighting an attitude, you're fighting a trial, a difficulty, and you keep losing. And what you need is you need to come to the altar. You need to come to Jesus Christ. You need to come to the Lord and say, Lord, I can't fight these battles on my own, but you can. I'm not sufficient, but you are. I can't win these victories in my life, but you can. What you need to do is you need to come to the Lord and you need to surrender. You know, we've changed our phraseology. We've changed our words, the way we talk about coming to Christ. You know, these days we talk about how you need to accept Jesus Christ. We like to talk about how we need to invite Christ into our hearts. You know, that's not the way they talked in the old days. In the old days, they said, you need to surrender to Jesus Christ. It's about time we got back to that. We need to surrender to Christ. We need to come to the place where we recognize, I can't do it on my own, but God can. God can. So here's Jarius. He's come to Jesus and he has shared his story with the Lord, and he receives a sympathetic hearing from Jesus. Jesus is interested in what's going on in his life. Jesus is concerned for this child, for this daughter. And he says, I will go to your house with you. What a blessing this truth is, that God is interested in you and your problems. The God of the universe, who has created all things, is interested in your heartache and your hurt tonight. Our God, who sits on the throne of the universe, knows you and cares about you and cares about your problems. Satan may have come to you. People may have come to you. Friends may have come to you and said that God doesn't care about you. Jesus doesn't care about you. But nothing could be farther from the truth. Jesus cares about you deeply. Matthew chapter 6, verse 31 says, Jesus himself says, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these things will be added to you. Jesus knows you and your needs, and He is concerned about you. So Jesus goes with Jarius. He goes with Jarius. Now, if you were with us last week, you know that he was in the midst of the journey to Jarius' house when something happens. A woman touches Jesus, and he stops to minister to her. Now, I can imagine how Jarius felt. You know, my daughter's dying. She's at the point of death. She's at the brink of death. Jesus, we need to go see her. We need to heal her. You need to touch her. You need to heal her right now. Come on, Jesus, let's go. It's right over the hill here. We're going to go. We're going to make a left at the tree. Come on, let's keep moving. Everybody stop slowing him down because he's got to go. Let's move along here, Jesus. And he's moving along, and all of a sudden, Jesus stops and says, somebody touched me. Well, he's being thronged by people. You know, Jarius had to think, I don't care who touched you. My daughter's dying here. But Jesus stops, and he deals with the woman who has the issue of blood. He deals with that situation. And Jarius is over here in the corner. My daughter's dying. This woman will still be here when we're done. Let's move this thing along. Have you ever felt like that? Because I have to tell you, it's just us here tonight, so I'm going to be honest with you. I'm an impatient person. I've got a schedule, and I want to keep my schedule. And when I'm driving down the highway, you know, if the speed limit says that the speed limit is 70 miles an hour, I'm going to be 75, and I am not patient with you for doing 65. I want to get where I'm going. How much more would you feel like that if your daughter's dying? But Jesus stops, and he deals with this woman and her need because he loves the woman too. Interestingly, none of the gospel writers ever record that Jarius complains. Whatever he felt, he never complains. What a mark of faith that Jesus has got this. He's come to a point where he's left his problems in Jesus' hands, and he's going to let him deal with it. But then tragedy strikes. While he is still dealing with the woman, one of Jairus' servants approach. You can imagine Jarius standing there. He's waiting for Jesus to get done. His daughter's dying. He's dealing with some woman over here now. We've got to get going here, Jesus. And all of a sudden he looks, and there comes one of his servants. And you can imagine what the servant looked like. All the blood's drained out of his face. He's ashen. He's got tears in his eyes. He probably knew what he was going to say before he even gets there. In verse 35, he walks up to him and he says, don't bother the master anymore. Your daughter's gone. She's dead. While he was still speaking, some came from the ruler of the synagogue's house who said, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? I have never lost a child. I can't imagine what that would be like. I can't imagine the crushing blow. The hopes and dreams of this father have been shattered and broken. And I wonder if in his heart he thought, if it hadn't been for the crowd, he might have made it in time. If it hadn't been for this woman that interrupted us, he might have made it in time. If Jesus had not stopped, my daughter might still be alive today. Have you ever questioned God's timing in your life? You know, if God's timing had been a little different, things would have been different in my life. You wouldn't be the first one. The Bible says that Mary and Martha questioned the Lord's timing when their brother Lazarus died. John chapter 11, verse 20. Now Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. When the disciples were in the storm on the Sea of Galilee, they must have questioned Jesus. Why did he send us on? Why didn't he come with us? But did you know that the Lord's delays are often for our good? You see, in the end, Mary and Martha saw Jesus raise their brother from the dead. In the end, the disciples saw Jesus walk on water because he had delayed his coming. Sometimes he tarries because he's preparing an even greater blessing for us. John chapter 11, verse 14, then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not here, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. So when it seems like God is moving too slowly, when his timing is not your timing, recognize that God is seldom early, but he is never late. What we see in a delay is often God preparing for a more powerful deliverance. So this tragic situation has been transformed to an impossible situation. What before was a tragic and discouraging situation has become impossible now because the little girl who was sick is dead. But even in this moment, it is interesting to see Jairus' faith. Jairus has put his faith in Jesus, and even in the face of death, he doesn't waver. In verse 36, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not be afraid, only believe." What a word of faith here to call on him. Don't believe what the servant says. Believe in me. Don't believe what your eyes tell you. Believe in me. Don't believe what your ears hear. Believe in me. Don't believe what your mind says. Believe in me. Don't believe what your heart feels. Believe in me. Believe in me. Trust in me. That's what faith says to us today. When every instinct of you says it's an impossible situation, there's no way out, it's hopeless, God says, Christ says, trust me. Trust me. And all I'm saying tonight is whatever your difficulty is, your problem, your need is, bring it to Jesus and trust him with it. Everything about the situation might say it's hopeless, it's not going to work it out, but leave it in his hand by faith and trust that he will work it out according to his purpose and plan, which might not be the way you want it to work. A lot of health and wealth, prosperity gospel, word faith folks will tell you today, if you will just have enough faith, God will heal you of your sickness. If you'll just have enough faith, God will work out your finances. If you'll just have enough faith, God will work out that relationship problem that you have. I'm here to tell you tonight, folks, often it takes more faith to believe God when he doesn't heal you than it does to believe when he does. God says, listen, I'm going to work all things together for good. I will work all things together for good. It might not be the way you want it, but in the end, it works out. In the end, my plan and my purpose will be advanced. In the end, it will be okay. And sometimes the end is not on this side of heaven either. But I'm telling you, trust that he is adequate for the situation. Take your problem, leave it in his hand. Give it to him and leave it there. In verse 37. And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. He's come to the house now. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw tumult and those who wept and wailed loudly. When he came in, he said to them, "Why make this commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they ridiculed him. But when he had put them all outside, he took the father and mother of the child and those who were with him and entered where the child was lying. Notice, Jesus doesn't put everyone out. He just puts out the ones that don't believe him. See, unbelief will receive nothing from the hand of God. It was not until Israel's feet touched the water of the River Jordan that God stopped up the river and allowed them to cross over on dry land. When Jesus entered the room where this dead girl is lying, he's going to perform a miracle. And he's going to do it for those who believe him. The Bible says in verse 41 that he takes her by the hand and he tells her to rise. And she does. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine being the father of that child, the mother of that daughter? And this child is dead. And the situation is hopeless. And you are overwhelmed in your grief. And Christ enters into the situation and he takes her by the hand and he tells her to get up. And her eyes flutter open. And her cheeks become pink. And she sits up. And she steps out of the bed. Folks, that's what happens when Jesus arrives in a situation. Things change. The situation is transformed when Jesus shows up. Verse 42. Immediately the girl arose and walked, for she was 12 years of age, and they were overcome with amazement. The word amazement here means literally to throw out of position, to be out of one's mind. Literally, they are crazy thrilled. They are crazy with excitement and joy at what Christ has done here. I want you to know something. Tonight, Christ is waiting to do something in your life. He is waiting for you to bring your impossible situation to him and to leave it there by faith and to trust him to deal with it in his way and in his time. For some of you, you need to bring your soul to Jesus. You need to know him as your Lord and your Savior. For some of you, you have a child who is straying, who is far from the Lord. You need to bring that child and you need to leave them with Christ. For some of you, it is a health situation. It is a financial situation. It is a relationship situation. And what I'm telling you tonight, whether it is an addiction, whether it is a trial, whether it is a heartache, Jesus is sufficient for that situation. Some of you need to bring a lost spouse. Some of you need to bring another person to Jesus today. Put them in his hand and leave them there. Whatever it is that is causing you fear and worry, Jesus says, I'm sufficient. I will change that situation. I will transform it, and I will use it for my glory. There was a Methodist preacher by the name of Luther Bridges. Back in 1884, he married a woman by the name of Sarah Veach, and they had three sons. In 1910, he went to preach a conference in Kentucky. He left his family in the care of his father-in-law and was gone for 2 weeks. Finally, at the end of the 2 weeks, he picked up the phone and he called his father-in-law. He was joyful and excited because the conference had gone well. There had been a number of people that had come to Christ and knew Christ as their Savior. He couldn't wait to tell his wife about it, but when he called on the telephone, he found that there had been a fire and the house had burned down, and that his father-in-law, his wife, and all three of his sons had perished in the blaze. Luther Bridges remembered the promises of God, and the darkness of that night, he penned these words. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in all of life's ebb and flow. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings and stirred the slumbering chords again. Though sometimes he leads through waters deep, Trials fall across the way. Though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see his footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. You see, the supply for all of our needs is found in Jesus. And I invite you to do what Jarius did so long ago, to bring that heartache and that grief and whatever it is that is burdening you, and to leave it at the feet of Christ, recognizing that he is sufficient for every situation. Do you have a loved one that needs to be saved? He can do that. Do you have a problem that you can't solve? He can handle that. Do you need grace to go through a valley, strength to bear up under a hurt? He can do that. Not because Jesus is some magic genie, but he is the sovereign Lord of the universe. And I don't know how great your problem is, but I know how great our Savior is. But you need, first of all, a relationship with Christ. We're mostly home folks here tonight. But I want you to know, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, your first step to being able to handle all of the issues in your life is to receive him, to surrender to Christ tonight. The Bible says we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. If you need help for all of life's issues and hope for life eternal after death, you need Jesus tonight. Just a moment, I'm going to be standing here at the front during our hymn of invitation. If you would like to talk to me more about knowing Christ as your Savior, or you'd just like to have me pray for you for a problem or issue in your life, please come forward. We'll be glad to talk to you. Also, the altar will be open. If there's something you need to just go and leave at Christ's feet tonight, let's do that. Recognizing that Jesus is sufficient for it all. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your grace, your kindness. We thank you, Lord, that you are sufficient for every heartache and every burden. We ask, Lord, that you would just intervene right now in the lives of those who are in this room. Lord, that you would lift every burden, that you would help us in faith to leave those burdens with you, and that you might glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand for him.